Our Heavenly Father, for all of these things and for all of these items of praise, we bring them to you, we offer them to you because we recognize and acknowledge that you are the giver of every good and perfect gift. Whether it is a moment to, or a few hours to be with someone and have them lucid enough to carry on a conversation and to share memories or to be in a place of great celebration as people mark the completion of one chapter of their lives and the beginning of a new chapter. Whether it is the marvelous and sometimes just amazing way how you bring people across our path who can help us for a short period of time, even if something is in some ways kind of mundane as helping pack things together to move. Sometimes it is in those moments where we just simply need someone to be with us. Father, we thank you for your goodness. And Father, we would pray, as we shared all these many ways in which you've answered prayers, that we would pray that you would help us to be the answers to prayer for those around us. There are people who are lonely, even though they may be surrounded by other people. There are people who feel abandoned and forgotten. There are those who feel as if there's no hope or no purpose anymore, and they're longing to have meaning. They're longing to connect. They're longing just to believe that somehow they have value. Father, show us, as a church and as individuals, show us how to be an answer to those kind of prayers. When that face or that name comes to our mind unsought, when it just simply pops in there, help us to hear your nudging and the realization that maybe this is you saying, give that person a call or stop in and see how that individual is doing. Father, we so often wait for the big lightning bolt and flashes from the sky kind of prods and commands from you to say, go and do this and go embark on that great venture. And yet so often you simply speak in the little nudges, the little whispers, the little thoughts. Father, we are thankful for so much, for more than enough nourishment for most of us, for the basic essentials of life, clothing and homes. Father, we are so thankful this morning for you. And we are so thankful. We are humbled to realize that even this small little gathering of people, this ragamuffin group of individuals who come from so many different backgrounds and experiences, we are all at different places in our life journeys and in our faith journeys. Yet you are here and you know each one of our hearts. You know where we are and you know where you want to take us. Father, let us hear your voice this morning. Let us know your heart. Let us be overwhelmed again by the mystery of who you are. By the miracle that the God of all the universe would care enough, love enough, that he would reach out to us, his creation, and in spite of our rebellion, in spite of our pride, in spite of our sin, would make it possible to know him, would offer forgiveness, would adopt us to his family. Father, if nothing else today, if nothing else, show us who you really are so that we can worship and be awestruck in your presence. Amen. We are wrapping up our short little series, Encounters with the Living Christ. I think I've got a little pitch up there. There we are. We've been looking at that 40-day period between the resurrection of Jesus and the ascension of Jesus. Instances when Jesus appeared, he showed up and proved himself alive and proved himself the risen Lord and Savior. And this morning we're going to look at the last one that we're going to be looking at together, studying together. It's in Acts chapter 1. If you have your Bible and you want to follow along as we kind of go piece by piece, we're going to look at this last event that records an encounter with the living Lord. Luke starts in Acts chapter 1 in chapter 1 verse 1 with these words. He says, "In my first book I told you, Theophilus, about everything Jesus began to do and teach, until the day he was taken up to heaven after giving his chosen apostles further instructions through the Holy Spirit. During the 40 days after he suffered and died, he appeared to the apostles from time to time, and he proved to them in many ways that he was actually alive. And he talked to them about the kingdom of God." So really, in this first few verses, this is really the summary of the different passages that we've been looking at, right? Luke talks about how Jesus appeared various times after his resurrection, and what he did and what he shared during those appearances. And then in verse 4, Luke continues. He says, "Once when he was eating with them, he commanded them, 'Do not leave Jerusalem until the Father sends you the gift he promised, as I told you before. John baptized with water, but in just a few days, you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit.' So when the apostles were with Jesus, they kept asking him, 'Lord, has the time come for you to free Israel and restore our kingdom?' He replied, 'The Father alone has the authority to set those dates and times, and they are not for you to know. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth.'" It's interesting, isn't it, that even at this time, the disciples, they're still confused about what's to come, right? After he was resurrected and appeared to them, they have this question, you know, "Lord, has the time come for you to free Israel and restore our kingdom?" What were they looking for?
Physical.
Get rid of those Romans, right? They were still, all they'd seen, they were still confused about what was to come, and they're caught up still in what they think should happen, in what they thought Jesus was going to do. And Jesus says, you know, "Look, that's the Father's business, basically. It's the Father's business. You guys, you don't need to know that." But what they do need to know, he reminds them of and shares with them. He gives them the great mission of the church, right? To go out into all the world and share the good news, to share the gospel. That's what they knew, and that's what they needed to know. And then it goes on in verse 9, and it says, "After saying this," giving them the great commission, "he was taken up into a cloud while they were watching, and they could no longer see him. And as they strained to see him rising into heaven, two white-robed men suddenly stood among them. 'Men of Galilee,' they said, 'why are you standing here, staring into heaven? Jesus has been taken from you into heaven, but someday he will return from heaven in the same way you saw him go.'" I think if it was today, it might be more like this next picture here. Oh, maybe not that picture. That's all you got? Okay, we'll get rid of that picture. That's not what I want. On your bulletins, I think there's a picture. It shows a bunch of people saying it looks like they're holding up their cell phones. Is that what it is? Yeah. If that was today, it's probably what they'd be doing. Right? Probably what I'd be doing. Does anybody know what a rubbernecker is? What is a rubbernecker? Pardon me? A gawker.
Busybody.
Yeah, kind of.
It spins around so much looking, trying to find out what's going on.
Okay. Yep.
He forgets what's going on in front of him.
Yep.
Runs in the back of the car.
Exactly. Every spring, I suffer from a condition called motorcycle whiplash. And that means that when I'm out driving, or if I'm even sitting somewhere in conversation with somebody, and a motorcycle, well, not always a motorcycle, if a Harley drives by, it's just like, they drive along. That can be dangerous. Motorcycle whiplash. Here's a situation where it's easy to understand the gazing of the disciples. The text tells us that Jesus was raised up before them in a cloud, and you know, I don't know if he went up so far and disappeared or just went up until he was out of sight or whatever. But you know what? I can understand why they might be doing that, can't you? If someone just started to levitate in front of me and started to go up in the air, I would probably be less focused on what so-and-so was wearing today. I totally understand that. But here's the thing. The angels, that's who these two guys are in the robes, the messengers tell us that, and in their words, there is a gentle, but it's still present, there is a reproof for what they're doing. Because obviously it wasn't what they were supposed to be doing. Men of Galilee, they said, why are you standing here staring into heaven? Well, what do you mean, why am I staring into heaven? Did you not just see that? Men of Galilee, why are you standing here staring into heaven? Jesus has been taken from you into heaven, but someday he'll return from heaven in the same way you saw him go. Why? You know, don't you kind of wonder why the reproof? Why the correction? Why the, you know, guys, what are you doing? What does this short little incident tell us, teach us, show us? One of the things I think that comes out rather quickly is that it's easy to be distracted. Because just before Jesus was ascended into heaven, he said something, didn't he? What did he say?
Go.
According to some recent studies, the average human attention span is somewhere between 10 and 12 seconds. Now, while it isn't scientifically true that our attention spans are actually getting shorter, I know sometimes we think they are, it's not scientifically proven that our attention spans are getting shorter, but it is true that there are increasingly more and more things in our daily routine that can distract us, right? There's more and more stuff happening around us. There's more and more stuff in our field of vision that can distract us and take our focus off from whatever it is that happens to be doing. There's so many things that are interesting. There's so many things that are instantaneous. We are in a time that if we aren't mindful of how we use and take advantage of some of these things around us, that we can experience what is sometimes referred to as sensory overload. Sometimes we go through life and we're talking and we're doing this and we're involved in that, and all of a sudden, squirrel! Just out of the blue, something grabs us and, whoa, what is this? Some of us are a little bit more, lean a little bit more in that direction than other personalities do. Like, hello, over here, I'm over here. Please talk to me, here I am. The last thing Jesus told the disciples to do was go. And what were they doing? Squirrel! And again, let's not be too hard on them. This is an amazing thing that they were just witness to. But before we let them completely off the hook, Remember that the angels did correct them. Move along, folks. Nothing more to see here. Move along. Right? You know, there are a lot of things to take in this life. We just can't do it all. I have a list of things that I would like to do. I don't really have a written down bucket list somewhere, but five things in my lifetime that I would like to do and accomplish, and I have so many things that they're probably not all going to happen. And we all know that there are things that we are to focus on, and there are things that we need to regard as important. And you know, some of the side things, you know, we need to be willing to set them aside. We know, and we understand that. Because there are some core valuable things that we need to focus on. But there are also a lot of things that can creep up into places of importance higher than they ought to. Right? There are things that can start eating up more and more of our time. And they're not necessarily bad things, but they're distracting us from the core, essential, important things. And how many times do I have to be reminded of that? You know, how many times do I need to hear what Jesus says in Matthew 6, verses 30 to 33? Don't worry about these things, saying, what will we eat? What will we drink? What will we wear? These things dominate the thoughts of unbelievers. But your Heavenly Father already knows all your needs. Seek the kingdom of God above what? All else. Seek the kingdom of God above all else, and He will give you everything you need. I know that, I know that, I know that. And yet so often I find myself living as if Jesus never said that. Amen. And they aren't necessarily some of the things that start to creep into my mind and start to creep into my list of things that need to be done and priorities. They aren't necessarily bad things. Sometimes they're actually good things. But we haven't been called to settle for the good. We've been called to the best. In 1 Corinthians chapter 7, the second part of verse 35, Paul said, I want you to do whatever will help you serve the Lord best with as few distractions as possible. And boy, are there ever a lot of distractions out there. What are the most important things in life?
Breathing.
Breathing is helpful. Bird, can you take care of
him? Family.
Family. Relationships. What else?
You don't have to have money, but you should if you want to live.
Well, it's certainly important to take advantage of the opportunities to provide for yourself. By the way, where do those opportunities come from? Helping other people? Serving? Yeah? Seek first the kingdom of God above all else. Remember what that means? A kingdom is a place where a king has authority, where a king rules. If we are to seek the kingdom of God, that means that we are to seek and to ensure that in our lives, in the way that we live, in everything, that we acknowledge, not just with words, but we acknowledge that we serve a king who has all authority over us. That we are called to serve and to glorify and to bring honor to. This isn't, folks, this isn't just a theological concept. That's how we are to live. Our King is Jesus. And the next question, of course, if these are the things that are important in our lives, does the way that we live actually show that to be true? Does the way that we live show that to be true? That our family and our close relationships really are important to us. That when we have opportunities either to work or to give and to help others who don't have all their needs met, and we understand that that's important, does the way that we actually give and the way that we do our work, does it show how important it is to us? Does the truth that we live in God's kingdom and He has all power and all authority in our lives, that God alone is to determine what we do and how we do it, that it is His laws that govern our lives, not our cultures and not our own. Do we live in such a way that shows that to be true? Or have some of our lives started to fill up with distractions? It's hard to always stay focused. It's hard not to become distracted in life. The other thing that this passage shows too is that it's easy to lose track of time. It doesn't tell us exactly how long the disciples tried to watch Jesus as He was disappearing before them. It doesn't tell us, you know, whether it was 30 seconds or it was 12 minutes. It doesn't say. The implication is simply that, according to the way the angels speak to them, that it was longer than was necessary. Is that fair? They were watching for longer than they should have been. And when we are distracted from the truly important things in life, we can easily lose track of time. Time that passes, time that is wasted, is something that we can never recover. We don't get it back to us. We don't get mulligans, in a sense, in that when time goes, it's gone, right? It's spent. It's history. That doesn't mean, please hear me, it doesn't mean that we have to frantically run around everywhere and all the time with no rest and no enjoyment, no relaxation. That is not what I'm talking about. We need rest, right? We should do a whole series on Sabbath. Hey, here's an idea on what Sabbath is and what Sabbath means. Busyness is not next to godliness.
Nobody threw anything in.
Good, because it's true. Actually, oftentimes busyness is one of the ways and one of the methods we use to keep running away from and hiding from God. With busyness. It does not mean that we don't spend those times simply in relaxing, that we don't spend time in going out to a meal and celebrating a life event with family or going to a party. Man, we should have more parties than anybody else. We have more to celebrate, don't we? We have more to give thanks for, don't we? So I'm not saying at all that we need to be always our nose to the grindstone, wearing ourselves out. That's not what I mean. But we do need to have an awareness of the finiteness of this life. And we do need to make sure that we live however many years that we have, both in hard effort and work for God and to provide for family and for others and doing the hard work of that, as well as the taking the time to celebrate and to relax and to be refreshed and to be renewed. But we understand that we don't waste. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 15 to 17, Paul says, be careful how you live. Don't live like fools, but like those who are wise. And then he says, make the most of every opportunity in these evil days. Don't act thoughtlessly, but understand what the Lord wants you to do. It's like, live. Live. Don't just let life kind of coast by. Every day that sun goes down, that was a day that the Lord had ways in which He wanted to show Himself to you. That was a day in which the Lord had things that He wanted to do with you and through you. In James chapter 4, the second part of verse 14, he says, your life is like the morning fog. It's here a little while and then it's gone. Well, it's all right because I'm going to spend eternity with Jesus. Well, if you're a follower of Jesus, of course you are. But there's a reason why he didn't just zip you up there right now. He has a life. He wants to be a source of blessing to you now. He wants you to be a source of blessing to others now. He wants you to know what it means. He wants us to know what it means to walk daily with God. And to be overwhelmed by the truth that we can walk daily with God. Again, not running around, you know, here and there, everywhere like chickens with their heads cut off, but to live life, to get everything out of every moment. Are you living? Are you living today? It's easy to become distracted. It's easy when we are distracted to lose track of time. And I know I've said this, but it's really coming home to me. You know, some of you would say, oh, well, that's nothing, no big deal. But I tell you, as 50 rolls around, it's one of those things I just can't get out of my head. I'm going to be 50 years old next week. And there's a part of me that looks back and goes, there's a part of me that's saddened by how much was wasted. Now, I'm not going to let that drag me down too far. That's done. It's gone. It's history. But it does motivate me to think, you know, whatever, how much time I get left, I really want to live. I really want to live. I don't want to be so caught up in my work that I miss the joy of watching my kids as they graduate and as they start getting married and having families their own. I don't want to just see that from a distance. I want to soak it all in. I want to soak it all in. As you, my brothers and sisters, as we rediscover over and over again what it means to know Jesus, as we hopefully follow, you know, even deeper and more wonderful paths in this life journey that he's given to us, I want to soak it all in. I don't want to miss anything. When I sleep, I want to sleep deep because I've lived deeply. I want to lose track of time. The other thing, the last thing that I notice in this passage is that it's easy to forget what we know. Look at all the things that the disciples were taught or reminded of in the first 8 verses of this passage here. When Luke writes, he says, in my first book, I told you, Theophilus, about everything Jesus began to do and teach until the day he was taken up to heaven after giving his chosen apostles further instructions through the Holy Spirit. During the 40 days after he suffered and died, he appeared to the apostles from time to time. He proved to them in many ways he was actually alive. And he talked to them about the kingdom of God. And once when he was eating with them, he commanded them, don't leave Jerusalem until the Father sends you the gift he promised, as I told you before. John baptized with water, but in just a few days you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Later on it says, but you'll receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. You'll be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere in Jerusalem, throughout Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. I mean, in the first few verses here, we have these profound truths that the apostles are reminded of. They're reminded that Jesus really is alive. He's alive. They're reminded that the Holy Spirit has come, that the Spirit is given and is alive and active. They're reminded that the fullness of God's kingdom is going to be established someday. They're reminded that until that day actually comes, the followers of Jesus Christ have a task. They have a commission. All this stuff, there's a lot of heavy stuff in there, right? In these few verses, they're reminded of all of this stuff. And in being reminded of all of this stuff, they're standing there. The early church grew, according to what God says to us in this letter, the letter of Acts, the book of Acts. The early church grew because They truly loved and cared for each other. They had meals. They prayed together. But there's something else that they did as well. And that's chapter 2, verse 42, a passage many of us have heard before. It says, all the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to sharing and meals, including the Lord's Supper and to prayer. So it tells us that this early church, this church that really God used to turn the world upside down, this church that God established early on and then spread throughout the known world at that time, this church of whom we are a part of today, this church began and it grew and it flourished in part because they were gathered together to fellowship. They shared together in meals, including the Lord's Supper. They gathered together to pray. But what else was it that they did? They learned. They devoted themselves to what? To the apostles' teaching. They didn't forget what they knew. They were reminded over and over and over again of what it was that Jesus had taught and what he did and what they shared together. They were reminded over and over again as they devoted themselves. Think about those words. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teachings. They didn't begrudgingly head off to study. And why would they devote themselves to the apostles' teaching? Why do you think that word was there? Why was it so important? Yeah, they understood. They knew. They recognized that without that, they're going to get easily distracted. And I know they probably weren't using these words or processes at the time, but without being solidly grounded in God's word, that they would be distracted, that other things would draw them away, that they would be influenced by, you know, the numerous false teachings that were surrounding them in their day. By the way, there's lots of false baloney floating right there today. And there's a lot of it under the guise of Christianity. And we don't know, and we can't recognize it if we don't spend time here ourselves. Folks, we cannot leave our instruction and our study up to somebody else's book that wrote about the Bible. We can't leave it up to somebody else's TV program. We have to spend time in God's Word. We need to devote ourselves to the teachings of the apostles. If we don't, we forget what we know. If I were to take my grade 12 calculus class test today, my final exam for grade 12, by the way, grade 12 advanced calculus, I'll have you know, I would fail miserably. I would fail miserably. Maybe if Isaac took it for me. Guy graduating with a math degree, maybe he would do, hopefully he'd do better than I did. But why? Why should he do better than I would? His reason? He's in it. I'm not. When I wrote my grade 12 advanced calculus exam, I did not want to look at calculus again for the rest of my days. And guess what? Yeah. And I've forgotten whatever I might have known at that time. It's gone. If we don't spend time in God's Word, if we don't regularly worship with others, if we don't practice the spiritual disciplines of prayer, of giving, of serving, of worshiping, we start to forget who we are and who we are to be as God's people. Because if we aren't feeding on this stuff, if we aren't, you know, guarding the input valves of our heart and our minds and allowing the majority of that what's coming in to be of God, it's going to come from somewhere else. And it's going to dilute and distract us from whatever else ought to be there. How focused are you? How focused am I? How often are we reminded of the main purposes of life in God's kingdom? At the risk of sounding a little melodramatic, let me suggest a couple things. If there are doubts in your life that are distractions from what is truly important, what are you going to do about it? It is of no help if we sit and hear what God says or we see what God is saying, and if we turn away from it and say, well, that was interesting. In the book of James, the author says that it is a sin to know what ought to be done and not do it. If you are distracted, if you have things in your life that are distracting you from the most important of things, what are we going to do about it? We have a limited number of days here. And again, I don't want to give the impression of adding more on and piling more and more responsibility. I don't think that's the kind of drivenness that God wants us to be motivated by. But we have a limited number of days here. We have a limited number of hours here. Let's value time as the precious commodity that it is. And let's remember what we know. Let's remember what we know. You know how you remember it? You keep coming back and reading it again. Oh, I read it once. Oh, good for you. I've read it few times. And I need to keep coming back. And I need to keep coming back. I need to keep reminding myself of what it is that God says. I can't forget what I know. I need to devote myself to the teaching of the disciples, to the teachings and the words of God. Which is itself a wonder. We have God's word. God's word. Most of us have been in this room have more than one copy. Most of us in this room probably have several. It's not an ornament. It's not a bookend. It's God's word to us. I know I need to be reminded. I need someone tapping me on my shoulder fairly regularly. What are you looking out there for? There's life to live here. Let's do it, and do it in a way that honors the Lord. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much. Thank you so much that you save us and you adopt us into your family. But thank you, Father, too, that you invite us, you really enlist us into your kingdom work. You don't want us to just stand by and watch. You want us to be a part of what you're doing. What a privilege. What an honor. But Father, we confess, I'm sure probably all of us to varying degrees, that some things in life we've allowed them to become distractions. And they aren't always necessarily bad things. Sometimes they're good things. But a whole bunch of good things cannot make up for the most important things. Father, help us to not let some of those distractions overwhelm us. Help us, Father, to be sure to understand what a precious gift time itself is. Help us to live life to the fullest. Help us to grab a hold of it and squeeze every ounce of joy, life, and service that we can. Father, not only do we ask that you help us not to forget what we already know, but we ask that you would reveal more and more to us as we are faithful to and faithful with what we know right now. Stretch us. Stretch us and change us and take us to new depths and new heights of understanding and experience and wisdom. As we plumb the depths of your word. Father, Help us not to forget what we truly do know. Be pleased to use us to bring honor and glory to you. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Father, may the words that we just sang together this morning, may they truly be the desire of our hearts. And as we go from this place, let us go seeking to make the lives of those around us brighter and better. Father, for those from our church family who aren't here today, perhaps for those who haven't been here for a while, Father, cause us, motivate us to reach out to them, to let them know that we care about them, that we miss them. And Father, for a world outside that does not yet know you, use us to help people discover who you are. Use us to point people to you. Draw them to yourself. And we will give you all the thanks, and the praise, and the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.